各位
members, this is the meeting of the subcommittee to study issues relating to mainland Hong Kong SAR families. Let's call the meeting to order. We have formed a quorum and we've actually gone past the appointed time. This will be the last meeting of the subcommittee in this session. Earlier on, we have dealt separately with subjects listed in the paper. And today we are focusing on one specific issue, and that is the policies and measures adopted by the administration regarding the use of subsidized obstetric services by mainland Hong Kong SAR families. The government has submitted a paper, LC paper number CB(2162-1560)-01, and the background brief has been prepared by the Legislative Council Secretariat for members' reference and consideration. And in fact, this afternoon, the Secretariat has received a submission from the Mainland Hong Kong Families Rights Associations, and they have given us their views on the use of mainlanders on public hospitals obstetric services, and the submission has been tabled. That's for members' reference. Attending the meeting today are Professor Sophia Chan, Undersecretary for Food and Health, Ms. Leung Kar-ying, Principal Assistant Secretary for Food and Health. And from the Hospital Authority, we have Dr. Ian Zhang. He is the Chief Manager, Cluster Performance. Thank you. Welcome. Undersecretary, would you take us briefly through the papers and then we can start our discussions? Thank you, Chairman. Members, Hong Kong's healthcare system is provided primarily for Hong Kong residents. As our public healthcare services are heavily subsidized by the government, it is necessary to ensure that our public healthcare services can meet public demands and at the same time can sustain in the long term within the limited financial resources. Therefore, we need to draw up eligibility criteria for receiving public healthcare services and a core priority to Hong Kong residents. Based on the above principles, we are offering our services to ensure that we have such services which can meet with the demands of local women. And since 2013, the HA has adopted the zero quota policy and reserved all beds for obstetric services in public hospitals for local women and has not accepted bookings from non-local women. Local women have high demands for neonatal intensive care units. Every year, the number of deliveries in HA was around 39,000. And the bed occupancy rate of neo ICU units in HA has reached 106%, and which is way above the 80% recommended by the HA's Coordinating Committee in Pediatrics. And also the 19th percentile waiting time of written cases in the specialist outpatient clinics of gynecology reached 1 to 2 years. Given this is the circumstances, the HA hospitals have no backup capacity to provide obstetric services to non-local women. So HA must continue with its existing policy to ensure that local women are provided with quality and safe obstetric services. Of course, we understand that mainland pregnant women whose husbands are Hong Kong residents hope to give birth in Hong Kong, and there is a consensus in the community that the government should provide help to this group of pregnant women as far as possible. In this connection, the government has established a special arrangement with private hospitals to allow this specific group of women to make delivery bookings at private hospitals on the production of certain supporting documents. With the above arrangement in private hospitals, the needs of mainland pregnant women whose husbands are Hong Kong residents to deliver in Hong Kong have been taken care of. All in all, as there remains no spare capacity for HA to provide obstetric services to non-local women. And there already exists a mechanism for mainland women whose husbands are Hong Kong residents to deliver in Hong Kong through private hospitals. The government has no plan to change the zero quota policy. Thank you, Chairman. All right. How many members would like to speak on this subject and to exchange views with the government? Mr. Lee Chek Yan, Mr. Yu Si Wing, Mr. Peter Zhang, anyone else? 5 minutes then. Mr. Lee Chek Yan. I've been following up on this matter for a number of years. When I started out, we were talking about the fee level of $22,000, now is $39,000. And I'm also meeting with, together with the mainland Hong Kong families concerned groups with the HA, and met with the chairman. And the chairman said all the time that he's sympathetic, but there's no definite answer coming from the HA. I heard what the undersecretary has said, but I don't think the matter should be viewed from the perspective of the HA. This is not so much a medical policy. This is very much indeed a population policy. Up to now, I don't understand what the government's population policy is. Do we want more local women to give birth to more children, or is it the government doesn't want that? When I talk about local women, I'm not just referring to the couple being both Hong Kong residents. That doesn't matter. If we look at the government's figures, I don't know whether the government has updated us on the figures. Every year, around 40% of the marriages are mainland Hong Kong marriages. Do you have any updated figures today? I don't know. For the 40% mainland Hong Kong marriages, my question is, do we want these group of people to give birth? When we say we want to encourage child births in Hong Kong, are we covering this group of people? This is a basic question that we must answer, and this question should not be answered by the HA. If we want to encourage childbirth and we cover this group of people, well, I understand that HA just has its own difficulties. But is this a difficulty or problem which is insurmountable? If you have a policy coming from the top that you must do this, I believe that you would be able to do it. Maybe you can do it 1 year later, not immediately. I think at this subcommittee, I would like we clarify the objective. Do we encourage mainland Hong Kong couples to give birth? Well, if you have obstacles impeding the childbirth among Hong Kong mainland families, and that includes a $39,000 fee, if that obstacle can be removed, then you will be encouraging this group of people to give birth to children. So my question is whether you are encouraging non-local women with Hong Kong husbands giving birth. Undersecretary, I would like to thank Mr. Lee for his comment. Population policy doesn't come under the ambit of my bureau. But given the circumstances or the present situation of the HA faces a problem that we have no spare capacity, and that because of the limited manpower we have. This is one scenario. And there's the other scenario is that for these NEPs, non-eligible persons, the rates charged on them are different, not just on the obstetric services. The subsidy level is different.
Even if we have surplus capacity to take in the NEPs one day, the subsidy would be at a different level. So I like to point that out. Now, two matters the undersecretary said that the population policy is not under her bureau. But we have to ask the administration, what is the policy? You can't just say it's not your policy. Now, they don't send someone here, but you have to tell us clearly, do you encourage them to give birth? Now, I'd like to ask the Undersecretary. Now, I've heard about NEP many times. Now, 39,000 covers more than your cost. So your pricing is very strange. If you go to obstetrics, it's more expensive than if you fall down and go to hospital. It's not consistent. Now, I previously talked to HA and they all say the same, $39,000 a package. And if I stay in hospital for one day, it's $3,300. So it's a large discrepancy. Why is it that you charge more for obstetrics, Dr. Cheung? Perhaps we can extend the time slot to 7 minutes. Dr. Cheung, we thank Mr. Lee for his question. Now, for NEP, if it's for other illnesses, we charge $4,000 per day because we have to be in line with the market. We don't want to compete with them excessively. So there was that consideration. That's our pricing situation. Now, so you have different charges. For obstetrics, they say they want to charge market price so that the private hospitals can make more money. So you care for market prices and you don't care for these Hong Kong husbands who marry mainland women. You don't consider their affordability. Now, this is an error by the Hong Kong central government. It doesn't issue any guidelines on whether it wants these people to give birth in Hong Kong. Now, if Carrie Lam says she doesn't want these people to give birth, you say you only encourage both cases, births in cases where both parents are Hong Kong people, then you should make that clear. You see, Wing, let's have it clear whether it's a matter of principle or of capacity. Now, if the mainland woman who is pregnant, who is married to a Hong Kong husband, is not an eligible person, so the government doesn't bear the wouldn't bear the cost. Now that is a matter of principle. In that case, the cost, the capacity would be irrelevant. Is that indeed the case? Now, if you say capacity is the issue, then that's a different matter. Please don't mix up the priorities, whether it's principle or whether it's capacity. Let me explain first the principle issue. Now, the principle, right now we have a high subsidy to give priority to Hong Kong people. Now, if we are to provide the service to a non-Hong Kong resident married to a Hong Kong person, it would be only on the principle or on the where we have a surplus capacity. And after 2013, we this has been the case. We have no capacity for these pregnant women. So we have the arrangement where if they are able to supply certain documents of proof, then the private hospitals will take them in. So my understanding is that whether the pregnant woman is a mainland woman married to Hong Konger, then so long as you have the capacity in your hospitals, you would welcome them. So it's not a matter of their eligibility, right? Our policy is that for these services which are in strong demand and which are highly subsidized, then we would give priority to Hong Kongers, and that's the principle. So they are not Hong Kong people, Hong Kong residents, so you refer them to private hospitals as a moral assistance on a moral basis. So members asked about the population policy. I think there's a moral obligation of responsibility to the Hong Kong husband. Now, Mrs. Carrie Lam said that she hoped that they should, she would like more immigration to boost the population. Now, in this case, the woman is not a Hong Konger. She's married to Hong Kong husband, and the children that she bears will serve Hong Kong in the future, because I believe the majority of them will stay and study in Hong Kong. We will consider subsidy, providing subsidy to these women for them to go to private hospitals, so that they will not consider Hong Kong an inhumane place. Would that be a compromise solution? We thank Mr. Yu for his opinion. Now, under the existing mechanism, when we look at these target persons, now our yardstick is that the recipient of the services has to be a Hong Kong resident. Now, if the baby is born locally and that baby would be a Hong Kong resident, Hong Konger, and that child would be able to receive Hong Kong services. So for the moment, we have to stick to the NEP policy. So the policy is very clear. But as I said, one can adopt a perspective of humane treatment. Now, at the peak, there were 9,000 plus cases, and now it's 6,000 plus. The trend is downward, so the government does have the resources. Now, the private hospitals reserve their beds for cases where both parents are non-Hong Kongers, and now there are less such arrivals, so they have more capacity. So perhaps you can adopt such an approach. Can you extend some subsidy, such as interest-free loans? You mustn't say that she's not a Hong Konger, so we have no obligation towards her, because the husband is a Hong Konger. Now, you haven't studied that perhaps, but can you consider that in the future? We thank Mr. Yu-C. Wing. Where there is excess capacity, as mentioned earlier, for these NEP non-eligible persons, where there is excess capacity, we can take them in, but we don't have excess capacity now, whether it's in neonatal intensive unit or in gynecology units. The queue is long, capacity usage is at over 100%. Now, in the future, if there is excess capacity, we would take care of them, but at NEP prices. Now, if someone has financial difficulty, in general, the social worker would gain an understanding of the circumstances, and the social welfare department would provide some kind of financial assistance. So these avenues are available. Chen Kuok-chi. Now, I think firstly, we have to look at the whole matter. Now, the policy so far is zero quota for cases where both parents are from outside Hong Kong, but we are now talking about Hong Kong husbands with wives in the mainland, and the issue is whether they have the rights to utilize services in the public hospitals. Now, the policy is that it's not that they don't have the right, but there is no excess, no capacity available. They are allowed to give birth in Hong Kong, but they have to go to private hospitals. So we see that in general, the most residents are not in very good financial circumstances. So some of them have to borrow in order to patronize private hospitals. So this would aggravate the difficulties in the family. So even if the mother comes here on a two-way permit, then the husband may have to stop working, and there would be financial reliance on the government. So in 2014, 39,500, in 2016, you expect that it would fall to 38,900. Now, this is the number of births at private hospitals, but we know that back in 2011 or 2012, the public hospitals took care of over 45,000 births. Now, we are not asking for services for 45,000 births. Now, say for 2016, you expect 39,000. Can you increase the number to 42,000? That would help many grassroots husbands with mainland wives, and they can utilize public hospital services at the usual cost, at the usual price. Would that be that great a financial burden to the public hospitals? Can you open up the queue to such families? I hope the government can adjust the numbers so that these mainland wives can make use of the services, because after all, their husbands are Hong Kongers. We thank Mr. Cheung for his opinion. Now, I'd like to ask Dr. Cheung to tell us about the situation at a hospital authority.
As I understand it, there is a shortage of manpower, well, in particular in the ONG specialty is very serious, and the attrition rate is high. So let's just see what the HA's considerations are. Dr. Zhang, thank you, member. there is acute shortage of manpower, in particular in the ONG, 13-14, 5.2% in raised stage rate, and 14-15, 10.8% last year, 9.4%. We tried to recruit as many as possible. We used to have 200 or so ONG doctors, but now we are left with only 190, and the experienced doctors have left. So we are facing great difficulties in going back to the previous level of childbirth rate. We are under a lot of pressure. We have redeployed some of the resources in the gynecology specialties to obstetric services because pregnant women can't wait. And the new cases have to wait for 100 weeks. So these we are under tremendous pressure. Mr. Peter Zhang, we understand all these. And we know that the HA has been shorthanded all the time. But this is not a reason for us to accept the reality here. Even if I don't suggest allocating 3,000 extra places for mainland women with Hong Kong husbands, the pressure is there already. And I don't think Hong Kong people's rights should be denied because of your shortage in manpower. Should the rights prevail over your difficulties in recruiting people? These are two separate matters. You must resolve your difficulty in recruiting people, and you should not say that, well, because you have difficulties in recruiting people, then we stop serving the mainland pregnant women with Hong Kong husbands. I think we still want to demand the government to do more to resolve the problem. Think of ways and means to say, to fix the problem, can't you hire some external ONG doctors to help HA? While these private ONG doctors have been charging a high fee, should they be coming back to the HA to help out and work for HA? You said that there is a manpower shortage, and as a result, people's rights have been denied. I don't think that argument stands. We understand it, and Dr. Zhang is just trying to explain the present situation, that they are under a lot of pressure, as I said. And if for other specialties, if there is spare capacity, we will serve NEPs. And in terms of manpower, in 18-19, we'll be adding some places in the universities for doctors, and by then they would be joining the field, and by that time there would be an improvement in the manpower situation. When the manpower situation improves, the HA will review how the services can be expanded. Before the second round is my turn, 7 minutes. You said that there is no spare capacity to serve mainland pregnant women with Hong Kong husbands. I don't think that argument holds water. The question lies in the policy. The Undersecretary said that you have a policy, and in terms of population policy, you will provide the care needed. And because of this policy, you are allowing private hospitals to serve these mainland pregnant women. So in terms of the policy, you think that these groups should be provided with the services. Now, this subcommittee is looking at issues from the family's perspective. We focus on what constitutes a wholesome family. Now, for a wholesome family, if we lack the mother, then it doesn't work. And if the women are not permanent Hong Kong residents, and if husbands are, then they still are not enjoying the service. But we want to promote population policy. We want to look at the policy. We do have the policy. But then you said that there is no spare capacity. Well, given the resources that we have in Hong Kong, it's impossible that there is no spare capacity. It's a matter of where you commit your resources. Now, Mr. Yu Si Wing suggested this. Can we consider asking private hospitals to help out? Can we subsidize, say, half of the fee or even two-thirds of the fees charged by private hospitals? Maybe these mainland pregnant women are already living in Hong Kong. They have already come to Hong Kong, and they get these women get pregnant, and then they can't enjoy the service just because they are not permanent Hong Kong residents. Maybe they can only enjoy the service, say, 2 to 3 years or 5 to 6 years, and in the interim period, they can't enjoy the service. Is this an appropriate policy? Is this something that the community can accept? We should encourage these women to give birth in terms of our policy. Even the children are born in the mainland. Under the basic law, they enjoy the status of a Hong Kong PR. But then you are not allowing them to give birth in Hong Kong. Is this a kind of contradicting yourself? If it is a question of resources, can you redeploy the resources? Say, if you don't have enough doctors, can you seek assistance from the private sector? I think that can help fix the problem. Hong Kong men don't want to see their wives giving birth in some other places than Hong Kong. That's very inhumane. Under Secretary, thank you, Chairman, for your comment, and perhaps Dr. Zhang can supplement in a minute. If the mainland women have become a Hong Kong PR, no, not yet. If she's not a Hong Kong permanent resident, the HA's policy is that she should pay the NEP fee. I've received a number of cases. They've come to Hong Kong to settle in Hong Kong. They are Hong Kong residents, but they are not permanent residents because you can only become a permanent resident after residing in Hong Kong. Well, that's not the case. If she's already a resident, then she can enjoy the service. According to the Gazette, she holds an identity card, even if she's not a Hong Kong permanent resident, she is already an eligible person. And if the children are under age 11, they have the status of a Hong Kong resident, and they are considered EP. So we're not following the practices of, say, the HA, where there is a restriction on, say, a 7 years of stay, and also restriction on one-way permit, and also foreign domestic helpers. Well, as long as they've got the identity card, then we will serve them. Well, put simply, if they come to Hong Kong and they have an identity card, then they can enjoy the HA services, including obstetric services of the HA. Is that right? Yes. So there is no requirement on the length of stay. They are waiting here to become Hong Kong permanent residents. If they have the Hong Kong identity card and if they are on one-way permit, then they are the EP already. Mr. Lee Chek Yen? Now, we are talking about mainland pregnant women with Hong Kong husbands. They get married, say, in Hong Kong or the mainland. The question lies in this. Say, if the Hong Kong husbands are poor, they better not give birth. So the poor people are penalized and they can't give birth to children or babies. Of course, you can say that if they can pay $39,000, then they can give birth. But then my focus is on people being poor. If they earn, say, $10,000 a month, and they just got married, how can they pay $39,000? So poor people are penalized. Now, if you say that you are not poor and you are willing to pay $39,000, and the mainland women come to Hong Kong and give birth to a child in a private hospital, and the baby becomes automatically the permanent resident, and they can automatically apply for a public housing unit. So that, well, let's be fair to them. If they give birth to a child in the mainland, then they can still apply for a PRH unit. If you are a HKPR and your wife in the mainland gives birth to a baby in the mainland, the baby is considered a HKPR and they can apply for a PRH unit in Hong Kong. Well, let me think about this. Now, if they haven't arrived in Hong Kong through a one-way permit, then the wife can't apply for a PRH unit. Well, that's the case for the wife, but not for the baby. The baby can apply. So what I want to say is that if you are poor, then you are in a disadvantaged position. You have to wait for your wife to come to Hong Kong 3 to 4 years later and give birth in Hong Kong. Now, perhaps they are newlywed and they want to give birth immediately. They can't do so. They have to wait for 3 to 4 years. So that conflicts with the population policy encouraging people to give birth to a child. And I think there is a discrimination here. But they are not covered by the anti-discrimination ordinances in Hong Kong. So Hong Kong husbands marrying a mainland woman and wanted to give birth to a baby, they are under a heavier burden then. So what is a population policy? Are you encouraging or not encouraging people to give birth? And the chairman, your observation is right. You have a zero quota policy for couples who are both non-locals, and your policy still allows mainland pregnant women with Hong Kong husbands coming to give birth in Hong Kong. Now, my question is, say if I'm a patient of orthopedics, I'm paying $4,000 per day, so I pay $12,000 for 3 days. But then for the ONG specialty, normally a patient will stay for 3 days. Of course, there will be body checks and all sorts of other services. So if you just recover the cost for the package, I believe that Dr. Zhang will also agree that we don't need $39,000. Well, $39,000 covers a 3 day stay and also one check, 1 + 3 equals to $39,000. I think they're profiteering here. And if they profiteer, well, the reason is that because they want to charge a market price. I don't think this is reasonable. You just want the private hospitals to benefit, and you are overcharging this group. Well, you are just working on 300 or so cases out of the spare capacity they have. Can Dr. Zhang clarify on that number? So if we charge an NEP normally, if say in the... you just charge your... charge the fee on a cost recovery basis, then that can be better. Why don't you do it? Chairman, you mentioned about PPP, private public partnership, and we are not asking you to subsidize them. We are just asking you not to overcharge.
Can
you move in that direction? Now, perhaps you have the concern of whether you have excess capacity, but you don't have to worry. If you charge $20,000, now you have excess capacity of 350. You have you're handling 350 cases now. So why don't you want to exploit them? Now some people say, why not charge $19,000 instead of $39,000? It's a humble request. Now, if you are short of doctors, I can wait, but the policy must be clear. You must resolve the issue in 2 years. All of them can come and give birth in Hong Kong. Then you don't discriminate against the poor. If you want better service, you go to the private hospitals. We thank Mr. Lee for his opinion. Perhaps I will ask Dr. Cheung to explain. For $39,000 or other charges for NEPs, whether there are similar principles underlying the charges, but we must have excess capacity before we can offer the service, because our policy is to give priority to Hong Kongers for the obstetrics units. It's not just giving birth. If there are problems with the babies, then it will immediately extra demand on the intensive care unit for the prenatal section. And that's already under excess demand. The capacity use is 105%. Now, for non-eligible persons, at the time, too many of them came to Hong Kong to give birth. So at the time, we calculated that for public hospitals, if we charge on the number of days, there would be too great a difference compared with private hospitals. So too many non-Hong Kong people would come to Hong Kong to give birth. So at the time, in 2005, the lowest cost is $20,000. So in 2007, we need to raise the cost to $39,000 for giving birth, the package cost. So the 350 cases, that's for eligible persons. Now, it's not 100 of them who don't go to the intensive care units. Now, we book them for private hospitals. Their cases are complicated, so they were referred to us. So the $39,000 cases apply to them. So there's no booking with us. So that's how we get the 300-odd cases. Now, after the babies are born, whether they are born in Hong Kong or in the mainland, they are permanent residents of Hong Kong. When they come to Hong Kong, you have to be responsible for them. But now the case is that the mother is not yet a Hong Konger. So there's a higher... So perhaps it's not a healthcare policy issue, it's a population policy issue. Perhaps we can provide some financial assistance if it's worthwhile from the population policy perspective, then you should increase the resources for the health care. Now, in that case, the money may not come from the hospital authority. Perhaps it would be resources from the tax revenue. The resources would be provided to eligible families. Now, even families with the wives from countries other than the mainland would be able to enjoy that service. This would demonstrate the government's concern. I think it's feasible, whether it's the package cost or the basic cost. You can have upper limits to the subsidies, as in other cases. You don't offer full coverage of the cost. So is there anything that can be done from the policy perspective regarding the population policy, the Undersecretary? Right now, in this regard, regarding childbirth, because of capacity and manpower problems, we do not have we do not play a big role in this regard. Now, regarding the document by the Chief Secretary, we try to promote the breastfeeding by the mother. This would be conducive to a family-friendly policy, and the Chief Secretary's document on population policy has said that encouraging mother breastfeeding is helpful towards better lives for mother and child in Hong Kong. Mr. Lee? Now, on health care, as I said, this is a population policy. Now, I see the development as this way. Now, so $39,000was on the basis that that the government expected there to be pregnant women where both parents are non-Hong Kongers, and now there are no such pregnant women. So the 350 is not about excess capacity. So historically, you want to stop those pregnant women where both parents are non-Hong Kongers. Now, still there is the problem that there is no excess capacity. Now, as I said, my perspective is that we should encourage childbirth. We shouldn't discriminate against low-income families. Now, maybe not all the members of this subcommittee are here, but perhaps we should consider sending a letter to Mrs. Carrie Lam, the Chief Secretary, asking how she regards this group of people under population policy. If the population policy is to encourage childbirth, shouldn't we also encourage mainland women married to Hong Kongers to give birth in Hong Kong public hospitals? Now, on the level of charges, in that case, whether it's $100 per day or $4,000 per day, that's another issue. The HA thinks that it doesn't want to abandon the NEP policy, but the Chief Secretary should consider whether one should encourage childbirth out of mainland Hong Kong marriages. And if the answer is yes, we should consider expanding capacity by hiring more doctors. So perhaps the chairman can consider whether we should write to the chief secretary. Now, I think we need to discuss how we deal with the matter, because we have to write a report, and that report will indicate what we think should be done. Now, there's under the population policy, we need to consider, say, these and other related issues, such as cross-border students. Now, but today we are focusing on the childbirth issue. The childbirth issue in respect of mainland pregnant women. So I think we have expressed clearly our wish. Now we hope that we should take a humane perspective. Now, pregnancy is a happy matter, if pregnant women, mainland women, can come to Hong Kong to give birth, so certainly it's good for the care of the baby, and it's good for the family, where the husband is a Hong Konger. So I think we should work towards that. Now, on healthcare policy, the government says there's no excess capacity. So it's not just a matter of the charge, whether you reduce it, the charge. Now, I overlooked your point. Now, when the mainland woman gives birth in Hong Kong, then the husband can look after her, and that is good for the family. It's much better than if the woman gives birth on the mainland, where the husband cannot go back and take care of her. So that should be mentioned in our report. It's better that the couple can take care of each other. Now, if we cannot let the poor people give birth in Hong Kong just because they are poor, we think this is not right.
I agree that we must have the policy before we fix the problem of spare capacity. Once you've got the policy, then you would definitely have the capacity, because we all share the objective of providing the service. The question now is, we don't have the objective of providing such services, and we just say that we accord priority to Hong Kong people and that there is no spare capacity. Unless you want to provide such services as a policy and increase the supply of obstetric services, then we won't be able to provide such services. If there is no policy, there is no motivation on their part to provide the services. So this is something that we must work on as well. Any supplement from the Undersecretary? I agree with Mr. Lee and the Chairman's points, and it has to do with the overall policies. From the Food and Health Bureau's perspective, if the government comes up with an overall policy, we will try to work towards the policy. Spare capacity is one problem that we face, but then if there is an overarching policy, we will see how we can work together with the HA to work towards achieving the policy. Okay, I think that's about it for the discussion of this item. Thank you very much, the three of you. This is the last meeting of the subcommittee. What should be the next step for us? How should we proceed with our work further? I think we have separately discussed many matters. Well, please feel free to leave the three officials here. This clerk would draft the report. So are there any specific requirements from the members? Just now we mentioned about the mainland, the subject of mainland pregnant women with Hong Kong husbands giving birth in Hong Kong. What are the points to note for writing up this report? Or can you say something on this? Mr. Lee may remember that you mentioned last meeting. That you suggest establishing a group for single mother in mainland coming to Hong Kong by way of one-way permit. Well, now they are allocating the quota on a discretionary basis only. I hope that there should be a specific group dedicated to this group of women. I understand that the government is talking to the mainland authorities. If other members don't object, can this be one of the recommendations, and that is for single parents on the mainland, they are allowed to come to Hong Kong on one-way permit, especially if they are single mothers with children. Now, but if couples don't have children, they may still be coming to Hong Kong by the traditional methods. But if for those mothers with children, can a special queue be set up for them to come to Hong Kong? For the for the daily quota of 150, I think the group has already been incorporated. No, to my understanding, well, they are allowed to come to Hong Kong on a discretionary basis. Of course, the children can come to Hong Kong. Maybe they are even born in Hong Kong. But for the single mother, she's not included in the 150 quota. It means that she can't really queue up for that quota. You have to wait discretionary power to be exercised by the mainland authorities. Well, my understanding that they can be included with this 150 quota, but then the power or the authority lies with the mainland authorities. No, I don't think so. They can never come to Hong Kong. My understanding is they can only come to Hong Kong if there is discretion. Well, we are talking about family reunion. No, of course, and we the child can come on a family reunion basis, but not the mother. The child can come, but he cannot or she cannot apply for the mother to come, well, unless he or she reaches age 18. To my understanding, this is only on a discretionary basis. The Immigration Department says that it is just on a discretionary basis. We can further clarify. Well, can we state our viewpoint, and that is this group of people should be included. They should not be put on a separate queue, and they should be included in this 150 for family reunion. Well, the quota has not been used up now, and in fact, this is really family reunion. Well, even if we set up a separate category for mainland single parents, they will still be included in this 150. So I will not argue with you whether there is a separate queue to be set up or not. So anyway, to our understanding, that would be part of the 150 quota, right? Yes. Mrs. Sito, I'd like to confirm that. They used to call it a couple reunion, say if they get divorced and if the husband passes away, then there is no couple reunion. And even if there is a child in Hong Kong, then there is not a mother-child reunion. So I share Mr. Lee's view that it should be included in this 150 quota for family reunion. Maybe a young child lives in Hong Kong and he is not well attended to. And if you allow the mother to come to Hong Kong, then that will benefit the child living in Hong Kong, the young child. Well, we agree that the mother should be allowed to come to Hong Kong. And there is another scenario cited by Ms. Sitho. The child may be in Hong Kong, but then the mother isn't in Hong Kong yet. But then in this interim period, the husband may have passed away, and then the mother, as a result, cannot come to Hong Kong. So she should be included in this family reunion quota. So please jot that down. Another discussion was on students. We are concerned on how to provide education for students. So what is our concern? How can we draft it? Yes, please speak to the mic so that everyone can listen to you. So what should be the content of the report? Yes, Clark, as we said last time, they are paying an exorbitant fee if they are to study in private schools in the mainland. Actually, I visited Shenzhen recently and discussed that point with the authorities. I think some adjustments can be made. I don't know when that will be done. In 2016, the State Council issued an order number 663, and it is stipulated that refinements should be made to the household registration documents on the mainland. Say, if you have a household registration in Guangxi, if you work in Guangdong, you can't enjoy the social services in Guangdong, including free education services, social welfare services, and healthcare services, etc. Now, authorities at the county level above are advised to pay attention to that issue, and for children born to couples who are not locals, they can't enjoy free education services on the mainland, and they must come to Hong Kong, because private sector schools in Hong Kong charge exorbitant fees, and there are also international schools. Children should be able to enjoy free education on the mainland, but they can't do so, so they have to come to study in Hong Kong. and they get up early in the morning, say at around 5 o'clock, and come to Hong Kong to schools. So should we be allowing children on the mainland born to local parents to enjoy free education services on Shenzhen? Mr. Li Chek-yen, I agree to that. I've also considered a similar issue that has to do with household registration. Some mothers are living on the mainland and the children living in Hong Kong. And as I said, we'll allow the mothers to come to Hong Kong. That's one option. But then the mother can't take the children back to the mainland because the children don't have household registration on the mainland. Some say that the child is in Hong Kong, is it 3 or 4 years old in Hong Kong, and they want to take the child back to the mainland, but then the child can't study on the mainland. Now, what you were mentioning may be confined just to Shenzhen. I don't know what will happen in Guangdong or what. Well, they haven't done it yet. They are considering it only, and they are asking the government or the authorities at the county level or above to consider it. So can we make this recommendation, and that is children with Hong Kong resident status can also be entitled free education on the mainland. Perhaps we can also include free healthcare services as well, so that there are more incentives for them to stay on the mainland. I agree to that. Can we set that out in the report so we can try to push the Hong Kong government to discuss with the mainland authorities on that? I think that can be set out in the report. Ms. Sit Ho. Yes, Chairman. Can the MPC and the CBPCC help out as well for children, especially in junior primary or even senior primary school, if they have to get up early in the morning, cross the boundary, and go to schools in Hong Kong, and then for a full day school, they have to leave the school at around 3 o'clock and then return to the mainland, and they don't have time for leisure activities, for play, and so on, and they don't even have enough sleep. So that is not good. So primary school students should study primary schools in the vicinity of their homes. If they live in Shenzhen, they should be able to study in a Shenzhen school that's best for them. Now, if some say people would like to study, to have their children study in Hong Kong, then they can do so. I suggest that in our report, we should urge the government to increase the number of school places in the North District so as not to create more conflicts between Hong Kong parents and mainland parents. Well, it's not just about North District. And there are school places provided in Sha Tin, Ma On Shan as well. That's because there aren't enough school places in the North District. Well, even for Hong Kong residents, if you are asking children living in North Districts to go to school in Ma On Shan, then that's very bad. And also in the North District, there are school premises which are not up to standard, and they're still taking in students. The best scenario is for the children to study in a school in the vicinity. Now, if they are to travel across the boundary to study schools and to study in Hong Kong, the EDB is obliged to provide adequate places in the North District for them. Now, if there is an increase, then maybe they will not be filled up in the subsequent years, and that would be a waste. Can they be asked to come up with an accurate assessment? Okay, we can recommend that enough places be provided for them. That's better, I think. If you just ask that to be provided in the North District, and maybe some years later, then these places are not filled up, then that's a waste. Can we do it flexibly, expand the class size? Well, but then schools are, when we talk about school places, we talk about facilities to be added, or else and then we will have matchbox style schools, and that is not ideal. And then students are now traveling to Mainland-HKSAR to go to schools.
Well, it's not that far. They can travel by school buses. Now, it's about 20 minutes more from North District to Sha Tin. So that would be 40 minutes per day. Ideally, the children will study in Shenzhen. Now, okay, how about social services? The concern groups also discussed about overage children. There are two categories. Now, we think that there should be opening up as soon as possible so that they can come to Hong Kong. And I think double overage children. We should ask about the concerned groups. The Labour Party, of course, support family reunion, cover the so-called double overage children. Now, we can write it into the report. We can then let the members see it, and we can mention the views of the members. So I think there is a consensus on the overage children, but perhaps there may be some disagreement on the double overage children. Now, on the school children, there is also the suggestion that the families should be persuaded to be offered the choice of giving up their Hong Kong residency so that they can go and study on the mainland. Now, we don't object to that. This is a domicile issue, so it's not up to the Hong Kong government. But right now, one cannot give up the Hong Kong residency. They are Hong Kong permanent resident, they are born in Hong Kong, so there would be double benefit. So it's not a problem with the mainland authorities, but it rests with the Hong Kong government. Now, on the services for new arrivals, any comment? Now, it seems that there's no major problem that requires additional facilities. Members only talked about providing some advice when they first crossed the border, the boundary. Now, we are concerned about the mainland women relying on financially on the CSSA payments in respect of their children. Now, actually, we didn't really discuss this matter last time. The information for new arrivals, this has all long been done. So that's all the issues. So we asked the clerk to draft a report based on our discussion, because we have to report to the council the views of the subcommittee. So we may not need to have another meeting. We can have the report circulated to members. If necessary, we can hold a brief meeting. Okay, agreed. So we would issue the report. It wouldn't be debated in the council. It would only be reported in the House Committee. There wouldn't be any opportunity for debate in the council. Now, unless the subcommittee is to be continued. So thank you.